Hey team, it's Tim here from RaceCraft. Welcome to this week's members webinar. Hope you're all doing well and all the projects are going great. Like we always do, let's start off with a little bit of an update of what's been going on around the shop for us before we get into today's topic, which is going to be an introduction to the AIM data logging system. So as has been happening recently, for a lot of our members webinars, I've been talking a lot about our SR20 powered GT86. Endurance racing car, which has had been much more work been going on recently in the workshop. So if you just jump across my laptop screen, I'll give you an update on the latest thing that's been happening with that. So one of the jobs the guys have been putting in the car this week has been a fire suppression system, which is actually quite a nice system. I'll talk through a little bit. What I've got shown here, just highlighted in the middle here, is one of the points of interest. This is one of the nozzles that sprays fire retardant into the engine bay. So what I'll do, I'll just jump across to the browser here where I've actually got a sort of schematic of how the system works. So what we've got essentially got in the car is like a large fire extinguisher, what people often call a fire bomb. It's like it generally looks like a big bomb or a big cylinder sitting there somewhere in the car. It's quite a lot larger than a conventional fire extinguisher that you'd have. The idea behind this is it is actually plumbed in permanently into the car with little nozzles sort of separated out around the car in different places, in places you would often either have fire or want to stop fire being. So the places we've got ours plumbed, we've got four nozzles in the engine bay, and we've got a few nozzles in the cabin as well to help protect the driver in case of a fire. So let's go through a little bit of the system, what's going on here. We've got the main cylinder sitting in here, which as I said, it's about this sort of size. It's relatively large. You can buy them all sorts of different sizes depending on the application. So for things like single seaters and prototypes and stuff, you often have a little bit smaller just because there's not enough room. But for us, we've got plenty of room. I think it's roughly a 4kg system, something like that. And you can see where we've got different nozzles splitting off here. In fact, this isn't quite the right one. It's more like this one. Sorry, it's more like this one here. So we've got a few different nozzles splitting off to the engine bay. So we've got the four nozzles I talked about on one set each side of the engine bay here. And it's not shown in this picture, but we've also got some nozzles heading off towards the driver, particularly around the footwell as well, just to protect the driver in case of a fire. So the idea here is that if you've got a fire on track, you've stopped the car somewhere, rather than having a little fire extinguisher, you've got to get out, usually bolted down somewhere on the passenger side, get out and put the fire out in the car. You can just press a button and it'll automatically unload all of the fire suppressant inside the engine bay, which is often where you've actually got the fire to deal with. So we've got our little nozzles facing to each side of the engine, one sort of facing quite low on each side of the engine and one quite up high. So to sort of spray above the engine and also onto the engine block. It's usually things like fuel or oil fires you're dealing with. Sometimes, you know, you can often end up with something like a ruptured oil line, or maybe it's as a result of a crash. You've had like maybe an oil cooler line split or something like that. It's just the idea here is it absolutely coats the entire engine bay. Anytime you do have a fire on track, but if you're using an old school fire extinguisher, like a normal bolt down one, while that is definitely better than nothing, the time it usually takes you to, after you sort of get out of the daze of having that crash or getting pulled over, get the fire extinguisher out, go around, unpop the bonnet, which even in itself can be a really dangerous thing because just popping that bonnet, you can often have flames and stuff in there. It can be a pretty hazardous thing to do. That takes a lot of time to get in there and do that. And usually the fire extinguishers we carry in our cars usually aren't that big anyway. So having the ability to just be able to press a button and completely just unload a whole lot of fire retardant inside both the engine bay and the passenger compartment is a really, really big safety advantage. You'll see down here, we've got a couple of the little buttons. So there's usually one inside the cockpit and one external, sort of similar in a similar way to how a kill switch would work. The driver needs to be able to activate it, and also someone outside the car, if whether or not the driver's incapacitated, maybe the driver's just concentrating, getting the hell out of there if there's been a fire, having someone be able to activate that from outside the car is really important as well. It has got this little electronic control unit, which is part of the system as well. And one of the functions that's really important for is that it allows you to arm and unarm the system. So if you're ever testing the system, or you want to make sure that if you've got the car in the workshop or it's not on track for whatever reason, you want to disarm the system to stop someone accidentally bumping one of those buttons or something like that, it's really important to be able to disable the system. Obviously, it's got to be part of your procedure to re-enable it before it goes on track, but it is really nice to be able to do that. I have seen myself a number of race cars over the years having the fire suppression system set off inadvertently, and it does make a huge mess which has to take a lot of time to clean up. So it's really something you don't want to have go off in your car. And saying that, if you have a fire, it's absolutely, you know, you can see with how well it spreads foam everywhere. It's a really big advantage, obviously. I'd rather be cleaning up a whole lot of mess from the fire system than have my car burn to the ground in the first place. So just jumping back to that picture there. So this is just one of those nozzles, which is actually this view, this perspective we're looking at is actually kind of just from above the firewall looking forward. So this is the left-hand strut tower here. And this is one of those nozzles, which you can see here. It's just going to be essentially sending foam out onto the lower side of the engine block. The engine block is sort of just out of shot in this area here. So that's been one of the projects that's been going for the guys. The other one, which a lot of the guys in the workshop are really excited about, is our aero upgrades for the car. So far, this car has been relatively basic as far as aerodynamics. It's really been running essentially completely stock. Apart from some cooling upgrades and obviously the engine and driveline upgrades, but from an aerodynamic perspective, it's been really, really simple. What we're doing, probably the two biggest elements we're adding, well, there's three big elements we're adding on. We've got a large front splitter and diffuser setup. We've also got a large rear diffuser and a really large rear wing, which has all actually been designed for us by an external company, but it's all designed to work together. So this is a little bit of a shot here. You can see the front splitter sort of mounted up in place there. We're in the middle of finding a way to join the bumper to the splitter, but you can see here you can see these contours here to indicate the tunnels. These are the venturis that sit in the front floor, which are a big part of creating that downforce from the front splitter. We can also see this is our engine oil cooler duct outlet here. So the oil coolers in this car sit around about here, and this is the outlet duct. The inlet duct isn't actually shown in this picture, but it's in this area here. So the flow from the ducts goes in behind the bumper there and flows out the side. But the point really to take note of here in this front splitter is this big front diffuser, which sits here. While we're there, we're also taking the opportunity to clean up a few things on the front of the bumper as well. You see we've got a fill-in plate here, which is covering the factory sort of fog light hole that they have. And we're in the process of building a fiberglass front lip to sort of join, fill that void between the front splitter and the bumper. So that's work that's ongoing as well. At the back of the car, you can see we've got... maybe it doesn't look quite as big as it actually is in person, but this rear diffuser is absolutely enormous. It goes sort of right up just in front of the center line of the rear wheels there. It's a really, really massive diffuser. And it's got a rear wing that goes with it as well, which you can see we've got a couple of big rear end plates there. So there's actually been quite a lot of work going on into mounting the diffuser and the wing together. They actually share a lot of the same common mounts with the way we wanted this particular car to work. We've got these sort of big cantilevered mounts up here that go up from the rear of the car and over the top of the boot lid. The idea here is that we do need to be able to get into the boot of this car. Not so much during a race, but just for service. We've got the fuel surge tank and everything in there. We do need to be able to get in there relatively quickly. So rather than the boot being on hinges as it was before, it's now going to be on pins. So it's going to be a little bit slower to get in there, but still we do have the ability to get in there without having to take the wing off. And certainly for something like this, while it does make the design and mounting of the wing a little bit more complex and maybe a little bit more compromised in terms of the structural mounting, having that serviceability to be able to get into the boot without having to unbolt the wing, I think anyway, is a compromise worth making. Got another shot of it here from the other side. You can see the guys have started mocking up an end plate on there, which doesn't actually look super big from this angle, sort of looking from that back corner there, but it's sort of this big in person. It's really, really, it's a massive cord on that wing. You can see a little bit more detail here, just if I zoom in a little bit. You can see some of the details of how we've got these aluminium plates. So essentially these mount to the to some mounting points that are built into the diffuser there. And then we've got the rear wing mounts that integrate into those diffuser mounts. So it's sort of trying to share some of the common mounting. This mounting in this photo, particular photo here, isn't actually finished. There's a bit more to go on here. We've got some more mountings to bolt it to the rear structure of the car there. So essentially all the places this is mounted, the front of the diffuser sits on pins into the rear subframe. Then this section here bolts onto our rear crash bar. Our rear crash bar has had some gussets and everything added in here. The rear wing mount sort of mounts to the a common area at the bottom there. And it's also going to have this area at the front. So certainly in some ways it's somewhat of a compromise mounting, but as I said, we really wanted to leave it pretty free at the top here so we could get the boot lid off without having to remove the wing, which in my opinion is probably too much of a compromise. If you have to unbolt it, it becomes really slow to work on the car. So we've had a couple of YouTube videos going out recently. I'll just jump across to where I've got one of those shown. This one was just a quick sort of tech video I did for people on three common mistakes people are doing when they're setting up their data logger. So it's, if you're going through the process of setting up a logger for yourself, it's probably worth just checking out this video. You can see the title of the video here. You can find that on the RaceCraft YouTube channel. The points I go through there are sorting out the start and stop conditions. So what I mean by that are the automatic conditions by whether you start and stop your logging. So in some systems, you can make this manual. You can make it just turning the logger on or hitting record on the logger, depending on the system. I find most of the time it's much better to have an automatic start and stop condition. So what I mean by that is you can tell the logger to look for a certain number of conditions, and when those conditions are met, it'll start, and then a different set of conditions for stopping. So it's usually something like the vehicle must be moving and the engine speed must be above this. And if those, both those conditions are true, then it'll start logging. It really just, it's a massive help not having to remember to turn it on, making sure you've always got the logger running consistently, starting and stopping under the same sort of conditions. So that's one thing I often see people making a mistake with, not getting those start and stop conditions working properly. The other thing, which is maybe a bit boring for a lot of people, is data management. So what I mean by that is organizing and structuring the way your log data is set out in your computer. So this really starts with the setup of the logger, and that every time you download a log file, you're telling it whereabouts in your folder structure you want to store that data. So for me, that's really important as far as organizing your data structure. The way I normally do it is in a hierarchy based on circuit. So the circuit I'm going to, after the circuit, I go to the event type. So if I'm running multiple events at that one circuit or within a certain year, whether it's test days, whether it's race days, I like to set them up in order. So I usually have a number preceding the folder name. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then a description of the event type. And then within that event folder, I have the log data for that particular event. So it sort of gives me from year to circuit to event. And that, the beauty of that is if I'm ever wanting to go back and look at some old data, it makes it really easy to go back and find it. So usually I'll be thinking, oh, what did I do last time I was at this particular circuit? I want to go back and look at last year's data, whether I'm looking at fuel consumption or whether I'm looking at setup stuff or the way the driver was driving the car to do some overlays. It just makes it really quick to be able to go through and check that, because I know the year I'm looking for, I know the circuit I'm looking for, I know the event I'm looking for, and it makes it really quick. And I do see a lot of people just sort of dumping all of their data into a common folder. Different logging systems can make it harder or easier to filter that out. So some systems use a database style system, others don't, and just use sort of a bulk file, a normal sort of folder file structure system. And some are better than others as far as filtering out results. My personal approach with most logging systems is to set up the same style of hierarchy in my data management. It's something I feel very strongly about, because making the data organized makes it far, far easier to make use of later. And the last thing I talk about in this video is talking all about details. So going ahead and adding some information to each one of your log files. So what I mean is most logging systems will give you the ability to be able to go through and add some comments about what happened in that particular download or run. Again, I just find that really useful for going ahead and giving some context around that log file. So say you made a setup change, or you put a different driver in the car, or you changed the tire set, or maybe the track conditions changed, whatever it is. That's just a really, it's something to keep in mind. And again, it just adds a lot more context, particularly if you're going back and looking at this data from a long way further back. Having a little bit of information in the log file is a really, really important thing. So go and check that video out if you're interested in hearing a little bit more about that. Just jump across to the RaceCraft forum. There was a forum post that's been a bit of a long one going. It's sort of keep getting extended and extended, and I thought it would be a useful one to talk about if you're interested in checking it out for yourself. It's under the motorsport wheel alignment section and choosing your ideal ride height. So this thread started with one of our members, Nick Windsor, who was interested in sort of the basic start setup procedure for setting up your ride height. He's going through a pretty big conversion. I'm pretty sure this is a Celica GT4 that he's running. He's actually doing a front upright conversion to it, to a different style upright and wheel bearing assembly and everything. And interestingly, this is out of a Toyota Prius of all things, which is pretty interesting. It's the first time I've seen or heard of anyone using this style of upright. And I can see one of the reasons he's probably done that is because it's a nice all cast aluminium upright, which is relatively rare for seeing something in road cars like that. So I can see what part of the attraction was with that as well. And I think part of it was probably to do with maybe potentially having that unboltable wheel bearing pack on there as well, which is a nice way to do things as far as being able to change the bearing sizes or change your offset or change your PCD on your wheel studs as well. So I'm sure there's more to it than that, but that's what I see by looking at that straight away. But the thing that's been added to most recently in the last few days was Nick was asking a question about how to deal with steering lock and as far as interference with your tires. So one of the things what I mean by that is, as far as when you add steering lock to it, obviously he's doing a lot of modifications to his front geometry. He wants to make sure he's not going to have too much interference between either inner or the outer guards or fenders between that and his tires. So the starting point I suggested there was to make sure that at least at your designed ride height, make sure that you can get to full lock one direction to the other without having any interference. So the only time you're really going to use that full lock is when you're sort of maneuvering around the garage or the pit lane, when you're getting in and out of your pit bay. It's not something you actually use on track. It's actually surprising how little amount of steering lock you do tend to use on track. So the point I'm making there is that the most important thing to make sure where you've got your full travel is where you can make sure you've got full travel without touching anything is at your static ride height, because usually you're just using that when you're just maneuvering around really slowly. After that, you've really got to look at how much steering lock you're likely to use at the maximum point on track. So whether you're going to multiple tracks or if you've got one home track you're sort of designing for, you need to look at what the maximum steering input you're getting as far as deciding how much steering input you need to be able to allow for with some of your bump travel. So obviously there's lots of different ways you can come up with that. You can do it from log data if you've got damper potentiometers. You can do some really basic hand calculations to work out how compressed that outside front tire is going to be. And you can look at, again, either log data or even in-car camera to see how much steering lock you're using at the maximum, the tightest corner you've got on track. So that's sort of some of the approach I discussed with Nick as far as designing how much clearance he needs to allow for in order to not have any rubbing. It is a pretty destructive thing having any tire rubbing, or it can be quite destructive having tire rubbing, particularly on things like inner and outer guards. As far as putting cuts in the tires, it's definitely something you want to avoid. Something you will see quite a lot when you've got cars with quite wide wheels, certainly when they're lowered and they've got wide wheels or tall tires in particular, you will quite often see interference problems caused by just having not enough room in the inner guard. And one of the common solutions there is to add rack stops just to limit the amount of rack travel you've got in the front of the car. And obviously that does have the downside of just meaning the car is going to be more difficult to maneuver. You're not going to be able to turn as tightly. But again, that's generally only a problem when you're maneuvering around the pit lane or in out of a garage or something like that. It's when you're on track. As long as you're not getting crazy, then adding some rack stops just to save, stop you running into your bodywork and stuff is a totally legitimate option. It's something we use on all of our cars here at RaceCraft. So that's more or less it for the pre-show. Just wanted to remind you guys, we have got more courses coming down the pipeline. So our Race Driver Fundamentals course, I think, has actually just been released over today, or maybe actually tomorrow, for that going live. So that's all about, we've got a professional driving instructor in to teach all of the fundamentals of race driving, which is a really fantastic course. We've also got our Suspension Fundamentals course coming down the pipeline as well, which is slated for release in about a month's time, which is going to be a bit of a 101 on suspension, all of the elements of suspension design, different suspension types, suspension tuning. It's going to be a really, really useful course for a lot of our members, I'm sure. So guys, that's it for the pre-show. I'll come back to you in a second when we'll get into the main topic of today's introduction to the AIM data logging system. If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.